Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
So love gives me that provision. I resolve V between 2 and 3, and I resolve VP also. Now the dot moves over VP. In the rule S goes to NP VP, the dot has gone over the whole rule and goes to the N. So this is a success of parsing. So it solves to an extent both the demerits of both top down and bottom up parsing. Okay, so this is look ahead parsing. This is LALR parsing. Okay, LALR one, if you look at only one symbol ahead. Okay, so this is how the top down bottom up parsing works. I'll just emphasize the top down and bottom up alternation part, especially in the middle chart. NP goes to N. People is resolved by N, not with V at all. That is the bottom part, bottom up part. And N resolution leads to NP resolution. Now VP gets exposed and VP's rules are brought. This is the top down part. So this alternation, okay, between top down part and the bottom up part is the characteristic of this top down bottom up chart parsing. And this solves the problem of demanding from the input, okay, demanding from the input grammatical entities which do not exist. So for example, though DT was brought into focus because of the rule application, the DT was never demanded to be resolved from the data. It was never demanded. So there was no backtracking after DT application and not finding a proper input. Similarly, the useless reduction of bottom up, that is people getting verb, that also is eliminated because the previous chart wanted a noun. Okay, it never wanted a verb. So verb is never brought in. So the demerits of both the approaches were reduced or eliminated by top-down, bottom-up parsing. So each arc represents a chart which records the completed work left of dot and expected work right of dot. If I take a longer sentence, people laugh loudly. So S goes to NPVP, NP goes to DTN, NP goes to N. Dot sits before NP, before DT, before N. Want a noun, found a noun for people, noun resolved, NP resolved. VP gets exposed. VP wants VADB and V. Dot sits before V and V. Laugh gives me a verb. V resolved, VP resolved. Now VP is resolved, so V dot ADV. Now ADV gets exposed. But S goes to NPVP. The dot goes over NP and VP both. So parsing would have been complete if the input also was over. Not so. Input is still not over. So now ADV work remains to be done. Loudly provides that opportunity. So ADV resolved through loudly, VADV resolved, VP resolved, S goes to NP, VP resolved. Okay, so this is how the parsing finishes. A little longer sentence, people laugh loudly. So top-down, bottom-up chart parsing has been widely used, very heavily used in natural language parsing. So naturally the question arises, are there other algorithms which are better than top-down, bottom-up parsing, which is so elegant? It turns out that there is such an algorithm. This is called CYK algorithm, Kok Younger Kashimi algorithm. And please note the grammar here, but don't worry about the numbers. These numbers are probability values, and they will be used when we discuss probabilistic parsing. So CYK algorithm will be illustrated through this grammar. Sentence goes to noun phrase, verb phrase. Noun phrase goes to determiner and noun. Noun phrase goes to plural noun. Noun phrase goes to noun phrase and preposition phrase. Prepositional phrase goes to preposition and noun phrase. Verb phrase goes to verb phrase and preposition phrase. Verb phrase can also go to VBD, past tense noun and noun phrase. Okay. So this is the grammar. Again, it doesn't capture the whole English language. It is only a part of the language. And here the DT is shown to be going to the. There is only one determiner, the A and N are not shown. The noun goes to gunman. Noun can also go to building. So there are only two nouns here. VBD goes to sprayed and NNS goes to bullets. Of course, P should go to with. Okay, there should be one more rule, P. So these rules where there is no terminal, no words, these are called grammatical rules. And these rules where we see the terminals or the words, they're called lexical rules. Okay, lexical rules and grammatical rules. Grammatical rules capture the structure of the language. Lexical rules capture the vocabulary. These numbers 1.0, 0.5, etc. are probability values, which we need to worry about when you do probabilistic parsing. So what does this grammar generate or accept as a sentence? The gunman sprayed the building with bullets. The gunman sprayed the building with bullets will be accepted by this grammar, or it could be generated by this grammar. The building sprayed the gunman with bullets is also accepted by the grammar. Okay, there is no semantics yet. So the fact that building cannot spray bullets is not considered. This is not at the layer of the NLP that we are at now. Okay, it is a higher level concern. Even I could have the bullets sprayed the building with gunmen. Okay, very comical and very absurd. Still, this sentence will be accepted. The bullets sprayed the building with gunmen, or sprayed the gunmen with building. So semantics is not yet in the scene, only grammar, and the grammar can handle these constructs. But the gunmen building sprayed bullets will not be accepted by the grammar, because two nouns coming side by side is not admitted by any of the rules in the grammar. Okay, the grammar tells you what is allowed and what is not allowed. Just verifying that you are looking at illustrating CYK, that is the slide, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Now, I show the working of CYK parsing. The gunman sprayed the building with bullets. Again, reminding you of the very high importance of these numbers. 0 before the start of the sentence, 1 after the first word, 2 after the second word, 3 after the third word, and so on, 7 after the last word, which is bullets. So 7 is the length of the sentence. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. So we place the numbers 0 to 7, 6 on the rows and numbers 1 to 7 on the columns. So what is the purpose? The purpose is that the ith row and jth column indicate a segment of text between ith position and the jth position in the sentence. And that is where the grammatical activity is going on. We find a phrase or a part of speech tag between these two positions. So the process has started. Between 0 and 1, I have the, and here I resolve by placing a DT. This is a reduction. The is reduced to DT. Going backward from the rule, DT going to the. So just look at the rule once again. DT going to the. So this is the resolution. Now I proceed, and between 1 and 2 is gunman. I find a noun here. Okay. And then I find that I can resolve the text between 0 and 2, which is the gunman, with the noun phrase NP, because NP goes to DTNN. Okay. So I have reduced the to DT, gunman to NN, and DT and NN to NP. This is a bottom-up parsing. This is bottom-up parsing. Now I proceed. Between 2 and 3, I find the word spread, which is BVD, a past tense verb. Can I get, you know, bigger structures after resolving BVD, just like I got a bigger structure NP between 0 and 2? So between 2 and 3, I found BVD. Now, if I go up in the column, I am looking at longer spans of text. The cell above BVD is between 1 and 3. So I am including a longer span from the left. So between 1 and 3, I have gunman sprayed. No, I cannot resolve anything there. I cannot find a phrase. What about above this, between 0 and 3? No. Again, the gunman sprayed is not giving rise to a larger NP, bigger syntactic construct. Then I come to between position 3 and 4, there is a the here, resolved by DT. As expected, between 4 and 5, there is building. I got a noun. Now DT, NN, I can resolve as NP. This is between 3 and 5. Yes, 3 and 5, the building. I'll have to, perforce, look at the columns above NP now, because it is obligatory on me to search for larger phrases. Can I find a larger phrase? Yes, I can. Between 2 and 5, sprayed the building, I have found a larger phrase, which is VP. And how did I compose VP? I composed VP from VBD and NP. There was a rule, VP goes to VBD, NP. That has been applied here. Can I find any larger phrase? No. Between 1 and 5, no. No phrase starts with gunman or num. But I am able to find a sentence within that sentence. So that is between 0 and 5. The gunman sprayed the building. And how did I get this S? I got this S from NP and VP coming side by side. Okay. So between 0 to 2, I have NNP. Between 2 to 5, I have a VP. So NP, VP coming side by side gives me S. And between 0 and 5, I have found out S. But the parsing is not yet over, because the input is not yet over. So I find now between 5 and 6, with, which is a preposition, P. And I find between 6 and 7, it's not coming on the screen, 6 and 7, a noun, a plural noun, bullets. And NP goes to NNS is another construct in the grammar, so I put an NP there. Okay. So now I'm obligated to go to travel up the column. So I do so. I find a PP between 5 and 7 with bullets. And that is happening because P and NP are side by side, PP. Now, I cannot find anything between 4 and 7, building with bullets, no. But between 2 and 7, I am finding a VP, 2, sprayed the building with bullets. Between 1 and 7, I don't find anything. Between 0 and 7, I have found an S, the sentence. And the sentence is now parsed completely, the whole parse tree contained in this table. And the parse tree can be recovered by following back pointers as is shown here. Sentence goes to NP, VP, NP goes to DT, NN, DT goes to the, NN goes to gunman. VP goes to VBD, NP, VBD is sprayed, NP goes to NP, PP, NP is DT, the building with bullets, okay, is the structure under this NP. So this is how the parsing proceeds, and CYK parsing is one of the most elegant algorithms in whole of computer science. Okay, this is a beautiful parsing algorithm discovered in the 80s and has been very widely used. But its importance lies elsewhere also. When probabilistic or data-driven or machine learning-driven parsing came, okay, at the time, what happened was that parsing, CYK parsing, was found to be very suitable for probabilistic treatment, because there was this alpha probability and beta probability, that is the backward probability and the forward probability, like hidden Markov model, which was very elegantly handled by the CYK algorithm. Even when you use machine learning or data and you are using probability, there is an underlying algorithm which has to be uncovered either by rules or has to be encoded in the weights of a neural network or the probability values, argmax computation in a classical probabilistic framework. Okay, so this is how CYK works. So we'll again go to CYK when we do probabilistic parsing. But you take a look at the algorithm. I have given a kind of animation to explain the parsing process. So now let me mention a few project topics. This is called project suggestions. Okay, so here we go by a principle. How do I choose a project? Either the work has beauty, okay, for example, music, or the project has utility, for example, chatbots, or it has both beauty and utility, which is a very desirable situation. For example, chatbot that understands and produces humor. Okay. So in top institutes like IITs, MITs, and Stanfords and so on, we challenge the students, researchers, with really cutting edge, forward looking, future looking problems. Okay. So I'm mentioning a few problems. If you are ambitious and daring enough, see if you want to take it up. So first problem I am mentioning is poetry. By the way, NLP community is very keen to break some ice on poetry processing. So translation of poetry, question answering on poetry are important and also aesthetically very pleasing. So this very well-known poem, Jack and Jill went up the hill to fetch a pail of water. Jack fell down and broke his crown, and Jill came tumbling after. Very well-known poem, you have learned and seen it since your childhood. Now, the scene is very simple. There are two characters, Jack and Jill. They go to the hill, and the purpose is very simple. They have to bring some water. But as is very unfortunate, Jack fell down and his head was broken. One of the meanings of crown is head. And Jill came tumbling after, rolling after him. So when I give this to Google translation, I get Jack or Jill pahadi ke upar chala gaya, meaning is transferred. Pani ka ek pouch lane ke liye, pouch doesn't seem right. Jack niche gir gaya aur uska mukut tod diya, mukut nahi, uska sar phat gaya actually. And Jill baad mein ladkhadate hue aaya. So it captures the meaning, it turns poetry into prose. It doesn't maintain the rhythm of the poetry. Somebody please verify you're looking at the Hindi translation of Jack and Jill poem.
Yes,
right?
Yes, sir.
Acha. So this is the translation, not completely captured, but it captures the meaning quite a lot. In machine translation terminology, we call it adequacy, which is the transfer, capturing of meaning. Fluency captures the well-formedness of the sentence. The sentences are pretty fluent also, syntactically almost correct. Aur uska mukut tod diya, this is not very idiomatic or syntactically good. What does Bing do? Jack or Jill pahadi par chala gaya, pani ki ek pail lane ke liye. So pail, it did not translate. Jack niche gir gaya, aur uska mukut tod diya, aur Jill ke baad tumbling aaya. So Bing could not really translate tumbling, so retained it as such. This is also a strategy in machine translation. If you cannot translate something, retain it as such. The user will make the meaning if translation is coming as a service. Now, the challenge is, if you take up this project, challenge is to maintain the rhythm. So Jack or Jill gaya choti par chal, lane ko balti bhar pani. See, the rhythm is maintained from English. Jack gaya gir, uska fat gaya sir. Rhyming is also maintained. Aur Jill aayi ludakti hui piche. So this is my translation, okay? try to maintain the rhythm, and some rhyming, la la, jack or jill la, gaya choti par chal la la, a little bit of rhyme is maintained, and balti is pail, jack gaya gir, uska phat gaya sir, gir and sir rhyming, or jill aayi lurakti hui piche. So this doesn't maintain the rhyme, but rhythm is maintained. So if you want to think of how to maintain the rhythm in poetry when we translate from one language to another, that is a challenge you can think about. Okay, almost nothing has happened in this, but people realize it is a very important problem because huge amount of poetry translation happens all over the world. Translation is a big industry. Poetry translation is a very large part of that task. Question answering on poetry: who went with Jack? Very easy, Jill. Who went with Jill? Jack. Easy. Who got injured? Jack. Not very easy. Okay. Broke his crown means his head was broken. Is a form of injury. Now, head breaking is a kind of injury. This is a hypernemy-hyponymy relation. Head breakage, parent is injury, is a kind of injury that requires a knowledge graph. Okay. So that resolving has to be done. It requires inferencing or entailment. So who got injured? Answering that is not very easy. Jack. Why did they go up the hill? To fetch water. Okay, you can. What did they carry? A pail. But the answer also could have been water. They also carried water while coming down. Maybe. Did they get water? We don't know. It is not said in the poetry. Did Jill slide down? No, she came tumbling. So tumbling is a different form of coming down than sliding. Okay, sliding is straight away coming down. Tumbling is rolling. Okay, so the computer has to distinguish between two kinds of motion: sliding and tumbling and even rolling. So these are different kinds of motion verb. Okay, tumbling, rolling, sliding are motion verb. They are encoded in a knowledge graph called verb net. Okay, verb net that encodes this kind of information. And you will have to appeal to those knowledge graphs. Did Jill to get injured? Likely, because she came tumbling after. And there is textual inferencing or entailing required. This happens a lot in judicial domain, information extraction, question answering, translation. What can be inferred from the text? So did Jill to get injured? Since she was tumbling after, might have got injured. So this is question answering on poetry. So much is left unsaid in poetry. That's why it requires a lot of subtle inferencing, deep inferencing. And that is happening in NLP through text entailment. Tweets. Okay, another project topic is tweets. The world of tweets is very messy, noisy, but full of a lot of interesting things. Tweets use very non-standard language, a lot of noise. So problems there are translation, formalization, normalization. Got to go. This is actually got to go, T-O go. Hey, what's up is an informal text, happens in tweets and social media. The formal version is hello, how are you? So hey, what's up, you cannot say to maybe your teacher. There you'll have to say a formal statement, hello, how are you? So conversion from informal to formal is a very critical requirement, okay, in language. So see if you can do that. Hey, what's up? In Hindi, are kya chal raha? So this hey becomes are. So exclamation transfer is again important for the tweet world. Humor is another project proposition. See if you would be interested in taking up things there. So mainly it uses text ambiguity. The officer is saying there is heavy firing to minister. Minister asks which sector? The officer says IT. Okay, so it generates a bit of humor because sector can mean a battlefront or it can mean an activity of commerce. So firing is going on in IT sector. That means people are getting laid off. So what is the ambiguity here? Firing has two meanings, at least two meanings. Firing by gun or firing meaning laying off. Sector has two meanings, the battlefront or an activity sphere. I filed a lawsuit against the airport due to my luggage being lost, but I lost the case. Sentence meaning is not clear. Okay, did I lose the lawsuit or did I lose my luggage? Okay, this is also a humorous statement. Then you can generate humorous statement by combining languages. Haldi is healthy. In these times of corona, haldi is healthy is very appropriate. And see, both the pronunciations are very similar. So these are some suggestions for project. You can think of your own. So think of a 2 months doable project. And if you think, you can look at some forefront of NLP technology and science. You can think of these problems, humor, wit, and poetry. Okay, I will have to stop here because the time is also up.